Over 100 years of horse racing history, and your home for what's happening today is Tommy Walski's Sport of Kings. Today, we'll track the man of the track. Stephanie catches you up on all the news. Our race of the week is the Emerald Down Stakes. Tommy will recap some of the major stakes in racing across the nation. In our trainer's quarter, we'll learn how to shoe a hoss. Our salute to the champions is a 2007 Preakness. And now here he is, BC's ambassador to the world of horse racing, Mr. Tommy Walski.
Here at Hastings Racecourse, whenever you're in attendance at the races, you can count on one thing. You'll be listening to the voice of track announcer Dan Jukic, and recently we took our Sport of Kings cameras and followed Dan for a day.
Here are your early scratches and rider changes for Monday, May 21st at Hastings.
I come in Friday morning. We do pre-scratch for Saturday's card. If we are racing Saturday and Sunday as we currently are, we take scratches on Friday morning. So I come in, put them on the phone line so our patrons can get the advanced scratches, get their handicapping going, and try and find the winners. After that, if there are a few tough and challenging names, which there can be at times, I'll head out to the backstretch and talk to the owners, the trainers, the grooms, and interact with them. You know, the backstretch is an interesting place, great people back there, and I always enjoy going back and talking with everybody. Well, race day, I'm here a couple of hours at least beforehand. I've done my prep work at home and handicapping. I've turned my picks in so that my partner, Mike Heads, can get them entered in the computer. He's always giving me a bad time because I like to wait as long as I can to see what the track condition is. Where, because his are published, he doesn't get that opportunity. So some days I'm better than him, but most days he's better than me. And then we come up here, get our overweights done, and get prepared for our show, which goes on about an hour before post time. Then Mike and I run through the card live, no tape, it goes live. And after that, we go right to the booth and do scratches and changes, and it's time to get on with the race card. Well, once the race card starts, of course, we've got Paddock Show, which Mike hosts, and I kind of chirp in the odd time, and if I have something to say, most of the time I leave Mike on his own, but sometimes there's a little tidbit that maybe he's missed and I'll throw in. After that, of course, we do post parade, then it's time for the running of the race, back to the winner's enclosure, and then it's off to the computer to put our results on the Team 1040. So it's a pretty busy time, and then the replay's running, and it's time to go back to the paddock again. Well, as well as race calling and handicapping, of course, I do simulcasting for BC for both racetracks and help out TBC, our off-track outlets, in trying to prepare a schedule for the month. We do try and do a lot of reciprocal with some of the tracks in that if they take us, we will take them. And so it's getting more and more difficult as we're reaching into more and more areas in the U.S. and able to common pool with them. There's only a couple of states that we're still not able to bet into, and hopefully by the fall time that'll be rectified. And currently that's Florida and, of course, New Jersey, and we hope to get into New Jersey because that's where Breeders' Cup is this year. So my days are very full as we go along with the simulcasting, and, of course, once a month it takes a couple of days to try and put the calendar together and fit the best product we can for the people who take us. Well, when we talked about simulcasting, of course, I do the simulcasting here at Hastings as well as for Fraser Downs when I mentioned BC. But because I'm not the caller at Fraser Downs, I get to do some other things and interact with the patrons out there. And there really is, as I mentioned earlier, there's nothing like interacting with the backstretch, and really our patrons are great. And they always like to talk horses, talk shop. We have a lot of good handicappers here in BC, and they always like to berate you a little bit that you couldn't find your way home, but we always have a good laugh, and it's a great atmosphere, and it really isn't like getting up to go to work. Well, after we finish the last race, of course, we put the last race result on the radio, and a new feature this year we do have on the Team 1040 is a two-minute recap where we try and give some highlights as to what happened that day with the stake race, and of course, if we have any riders that doubled or tripled up. So it's kind of an all-encompassing. We get that one done, it's turn the lights off, close the door, and head home.
Today on our Racing Across the Nation segment, this is the part of the show where we show you the view of some of the top races seen throughout North America, races that incidentally you can only see by watching the Sport of Kings. First up, we're going to take you to Maryland, Pimlico Racetrack, the home of the Preakness Stakes, you're going to be watching a $200,000 Emeritus Breeders' Cup Maryland Stakes. In this race, two horses to watch. Number 2, Diabolical, and the 7 horse, Talent Search.
And they're off. Talent Search, quickest of them all to the front, from Diabolical and First Word in Semaphore Man to the inside, followed by Fleet Valid, traveling about mid-pack now. And Celtic Innes has one beaten at Zero Code, who is a beat slow to begin and about 7 or 8 lengths off the lead. Talent Search and Diabolical has quickly joined the front, but Talent Search a half a length in front from Diabolical. Fleet Valid third in Semaphore Man to the inside and First Word a length and a half. Euro Code and Celtic Innes is last to make the far turn run with 3 furlongs to race. Very, very quick quarter at 22 2/5 of a second. Talent Search and Diabolical. They are rocking on the pace to get to the top of the stretch, and First Word will have the run at them from the inside, now tipping to the outside with a final furlong and a half. While these two are really putting on a show after a half in 44 3/5 of a second, they're cooking through the Pimlico home stretch. It's a showdown between Diabolical and Talent Search. They've opened up, and here's Semaphore Man trying to close the gap, but time is running out. They're in the final 16th. Diabolical and Mario Pino just superior here by a half length.
Staying at Pimlico, we're going to now take a look at the $250,000 Dixie Stakes. It's run at a distance of 1 1/8 miles on the turf. Horses you want to watch are number 12, Remarkable News, ridden by Raul Dominguez, and number 3, Cosmonault.
Remarkable News tracks intently in second, another 2, and here's Cosmonaut right there, a close presence in third. Stay Close has dropped about 6 or 7 lengths in the front in fourth. Einstein's got to get going now from fifth. Silver Tree is next in sixth, and Woodlander is 7. Can't Beat It is next, has been taken to the outside. Dreadnought is next as they approach the far turn run. We have a spill there. Mending fences went down, and so Remarkable News is up front. Remarkable News leading the way by 3 to the top of the lane. Cosmonaut in second. A length and a half in Silver Tree. Now has run and plenty of run. Silver Tree is rolling up on the inside now. Takes that third spot with 1 furlong to go. And inside the final furlong, Remarkable News. Cosmonaut on the outside is set down and setting sail. And all of a sudden, Silver Tree is flattened out. From the back is Outperformance into third. It's going to be a close finish as Remarkable News is holding. Remarkable News and Cosmonaut 1-2.
Now we take you to Belmont Park in New York. And this is where you're going to be watching the $150,000 Shuvee Stakes. It's a fillies in there. This is a race named after the legendary Shuvee, obviously. 5 outstanding mares in this race, including the odds-on favorite number 3, Sugar Shack, ridden by Eddie Cole. And Teammate, the number 5 horse, ridden by Carlos Velasquez.
Opening quarter in 23 seconds, and the odds-on favorite Sugar Shake leads 3/4 of a length. Teammate is running in second, a length and a half. Last Romance at the rail, Silmaril on the outside. Then Rahi's Appeal and Swap Flipperoo. Opening half mile in 46 4/5 seconds. And then midway on the far turn, and it is Sugar Shake in front. Teammate, Rahi's Appeal in between horses. Down on the inside, it's Last Romance. Silmaril back in fifth, and Swap Flipperoo. Sugar Shake, narrow lead. Here's Teammate now on the outside to challenge, and they're at the head of the stretch, and Teammate has taken the lead from Sugar Shake. 3/4 in 1/11 and 3. Sugar Shake battles back on the inside. Sugar Shake and Teammate, now they're right together with 1/8 of a mile to the finish. Teammate pokes ahead in front. Sugar Shake all out in second. Rahi's Appeal in third. Inside the 16th pole, Teammate with the lead. Sugar Shake is second. It's Teammate, and she's won the Shuvee.
Don't go away. The Sport of Kings will be right back. Hey folks, mount up. It's time to saddle up and ride over to the Trainer's Corner.
I'm here in the barns with noted horseman and blacksmith Brian Kozak, who is going to help us shoe a horse today. Also with us is Dave Milburn, trainer and blacksmith.
And I'm going to start just paring away some of this dead foot, the sole. Now I don't take too much of it out, because they need that to absorb the concussion, which in a racehorse is something like 8,000 pounds per square inch. Now we're going to trim away the excess wall. So now I don't like to take too much of this foot off with the nippers. Okay, our next step is going to be to rasp the surface of the bottom of the foot, and that's just fine tuning. And now we're going to start shaping the shoe. He's got some flare on there that I want to take off, but I'm not going to take it all off on the first round here. When you're getting ready to put this shoe on, I want to make sure that it's level to the bearing surface of the foot. And I'm going to have some excess here that I'm going to take off in a second. Now these nails only go in one way. And there's a corrugated side to that nail, which is the inside. And what that does is there's a little dent in this nail that allows it to come out the wall of the foot. Now if you went and pat it in backwards, you'd drive it into the sensitive part of the horse's foot. And this is kind of a feel thing here. When I first started, I didn't know if that nail was going to come out or not, but you can kind of feel it. Dave really helped me with that. Now there's a real critical moment coming here, and that's that nail sticking out there. You got to get that in there and wring that off. Now you need to put this nail in deep enough that it's not going to come loose, but not so deep that if it does come loose, it rips off a bunch of foot. Now I'm going to dress this foot down, and why I do that is because I can take all of this excess foot off here and use the shoe as a guide to do that. And just comfort that horse. Now I also like to just place that foot back down as opposed to having him mash it down. We've got a rookie helping now. And she's doing a good job too. Again, we'll get that hind foot over there. I'm just gonna have a quick sight down this foot. Looks good to me, to my eye. And we're gonna put some more nails in. The wall of the horse is thicker as you get to the toe than it is in the quarters and in the heels. So I'm just going to take a little bit of this burr out of there that was created by that nail coming through, so that when I clinch that down, it'll sit nice and tight. Try to get the nails all in a row. And you just trim these up just a bit so that your clinch isn't too long. So here's the clinchers. And you get those that goes on the bottom of that nail there. And these goosenecks kind of like so. And I'm gonna get that smooth, so if this horse were to grab himself on that opposite leg, he doesn't cut himself or a handler. My test is if I can run my hand across there and put a little pressure and it doesn't grab, then I'm satisfied with that. And I'd say that's done.
So there you have it, and now we know how to shoe a horse. Thanks, Dave, and thanks, Brian, for the lesson.
And now, to get you up to date with all the happenings in and around the track, let's saddle up with our own Stephanie Mercier.
The $45,000 Jim Coleman Province Stakes was run on Monday, and it was a great competition between CTHS Sales Stakes winner Stephenson and rivals Upashada, Ghost Pirate, the Saratoga Express, and Packer Sweep. Let's take a look at the stretch drive.
As they turn for home, wide into the stretch is the Saratoga Express. Upashada on the outside, Stephenson and Packer Sweep. It's Upashada on the outside, the Saratoga Express. Upashada to score, the Saratoga Express second, Stephenson third.
The holiday weekend saw trainer Terry Jordan take some of his horses east to run at Woodbine. Calendar Girl ran on Sunday in the $250,000 Celine Stakes against a field of 12 going a mile in the 16th. Let's see how she fared.
As they turn for home, silky smooth, and Patrick Husband's trying to catch them from the outside, but Bear now has opened up six. They're in the final eighth of a mile, and Bear now is turning the Celine into an absolute runaway. They're coming down to the line. A rock-solid performance by Bear now to win the Celine. The Fury winner, Saskawea, from off the pace second, Marietta third, and Silky Smooth fourth.
Jordan's other big horse out east is, of course, True Metropolitan, who took on some new challengers in the $150,000 Eclipse Stakes on Victoria Day. Jordan mentioned if his horses ran well enough, he would consider keeping them in Ontario. Let's look at the stretch drive of this race to find out if Metro will be coming home anytime soon.
It is Judas Wild Rush at the midpoint of the turn. Palladio is sent three wide and is coming with an imposing run on the far outside. Palladio, a magnificent move. And it's Palladio and Richard Dos Ramos who take this field into the stretch in front by two. Palladio has the lead. Judas Wild Rush is second. True Metropolitan is set down. Just Rushing is fourth. But a powerhouse performance by Palladio. Palladio made it look easy to win the Eclipse. Judas Wild Rush was second, and True Metropolitan was third.
The hopes for Kentucky Derby winner Street Sense's run at the Triple Crown were dashed the last Saturday. At 3-1, it was Curlin who beat out the favorite by just barely a nose in the nine-horse field to take the second jewel. It looks like we'll have to wait at least another year to see a Triple Crown contender. Also making news this week is an exciting new concept in green energy. Hastings Park, as you can imagine, produces a lot of manure that BC Hydro thinks can be put to good use. Basically, the concept is to produce an alternative fuel by trapping methane gas that is released when straw and manure decompose, and converting that gas into a usable energy source. The hope is that enough energy could be produced to power the entire racetrack. Stakes action returns this weekend at Hastings, with the Senate appointee being run today. The current Queen of Hastings, Monashi, returns to take on her rivals with a high weight of 124 pounds. On Sunday, the older horses have a break from running against True Metropolitan, and 13 horses were nominated in the John Longdon 6000. This sprint features popular Spaghetti Mouse leading a strong field, stretching out to a mile and a 16th for the first time this year. That covers all your news in racing this week. From down at Barn M here at Hastings, I'm Stephanie Mercier, and now you're back on track.
Hey, racing fans, time now for Sport of Kings trivia, and here is today's trivia question. Did you know that Seabiscuit and War Admiral were related? It's true. We'll tell you how in just a minute. Don't go away. The Sport of Kings will be right back. Time now for the answer to today's trivia question. Seabiscuit and War Admiral relatives. War Admiral, the uncle of the famous Seabiscuit.
Today on our Sport of Kings Race of the Week, you are all in for a treat as we look at some of the top three-year-old fillies on the grounds here at Hastings in the $50,000 Emerald Down Stakes. The distance, 6.5 furlongs. Included in this field is the likely favorite, Chef Sangara's Suver, who incidentally, if by some chance he does win, Chef Sangara says you might be seeing Suver running in the Woodbine Oaks worth $500,000 in the coming months.
Restless Lady is owned by Westwood Thoroughbreds. Restless Lady has been training very well for this tough spot, and she draws the top rider for today.
She's done everything we've asked of her. She worked outstanding the other day, or about 10 days ago. But this is asking a little more than she's had to run against. I mean, she hasn't had to run against the Chelsea's Images and the Suva, so it is another step up the ladder for her.
Chelsea's Image is owned by Nick and Pauline Felicella. Chelsea's Image is a multiple stakes winner sprinting and will likely set the early pace today.
Ward's, you know, switching to Chelsea's Image because Mario rode her last time too. And he really suits Chelsea, rode her well last year, so I'm not really losing anything there either.
Napa is owned by Swift Thoroughbreds. Napa closed well in the sales stakes and might just catch them today.
She's an honest filly. you know, obviously we have our hands full with Suva, but I mean, maybe the weights will be the equalizer. We're getting an extra pound again. There's nowhere else really to run these horses, so we'll take another swing at it, and hopefully the weights equalize it a little closer, make it a little closer.
Suva is owned by Jeff Sangera. Multiple stakes winner, Suva has to be considered the favorite today off her last big performance in the sales stakes.
He's a monster right now. It'll take a very special horse to outrun her. She's at the top of her game. Coming into this as good as a horse could come into it. She's probably not best sprinting, but she sprinted very well last time, and I'm very sure she'll sprint good this time.
Sophisticated Star is owned by Swift Thoroughbreds. Sophisticated Star is undefeated in the claiming ranks, but today will be a real test.
You know, the other race isn't going, and we're probably going to be sitting in the barn for 2 or 3 weeks, so might as well, you know, take a stab and see how good she is. You know, she's won by open lengths every time she's run, so, you know, you don't know how good she could be. Obviously, she's going to have her hands full, but, you know, she's going to be winging it on the front end, and the worst case scenario, at least she's going to set up an honest pace for my other fillies, so.
And now, let's enjoy this competitive field of fillies going 6.5 furlongs in the Emerald Down Stakes, presented by Kevin and Anita Sangera.
There they go. Field of 5 3-year-old fillies sent on the way in the Emerald Down Stakes. And Chelsea's Image right on the early lead. Driving up on the outside, Sophisticated Star. And at the rail, Restless Lady. Suva now sits in fourth. It's 4 lengths back to Napa, the trailer, as they head to the clubhouse turn. Sophisticated Star on the outside. Chelsea's Image at the rail. These two now doing battle. Length and a quarter back. Restless Lady in third. It's Suva in fourth by 4. And Napa, the early trailer. Opening quarter went in, 22 flat. As they turn for the backstretch, it's Sophisticated Star on the outside, and Chelsea's Image still head and head. Length and a quarter back now is Restless Lady. On the outside, Suva sits in fourth, 2 off the lead. 2.5 for the back is the trailer. Napa past the 5/16 ago. The half in 46-1. And now from the outside, it's Restless Lady. Suva takes dead aim at her. Chelsea's Image in third. Now Napa takes fourth, and Sophisticated Star a furlong from home, and it's Restless Lady with the lead as they turn for home. Restless Lady now by a length, Chelsea's Image. Suva, she's got to get more to do. On the outside, here's Napa closing ground. Inside of 16th, it's Napa, Restless Lady. It will be Napa to score in the Emerald Downs. Restless Lady second, tight photo for third.
You know, out of the gate, I mean, my horse stumbled a little bit. It looks like grab a quarter, and then and I just let her settle down because I know it's going to be a little pressure speed in front of me. And it surprised me in the backside how close I was. And then I just kind of hold on to the last minute because I know she usually hangs that last part. So I just wait. And turning for home, I got another gear.
Tell us, why the swing around?
Well, because this filly is huge filly. And she doesn't like to be in tight and tight. And you gotta give her room to run because a long stride filly, long stretch.
She's a hard knocking filly. She always tries. You know, race set up beautifully for her, and you know, she obviously took to the slop, and Frank gave her a great ride, and it was the rest is history.
The double teaming that you and Ned Sams were going to do, did it all work out the way you thought it would?
Yeah, it worked out great. I mean, you know, that other filly, I didn't really want to run her in here. It wasn't really, it just kind of came about that way just because her race didn't go, and she's just been training real well, and I thought I wanted to get a race into her. So, but no, it worked out great. Yeah, as it turned out, it was... You know, the plan worked fine.
Don't go away. The Sport of Kings will be right back.
Today on our Salute to the Champions, brought to you by the Vancouver Province, we take you back only 1 week, and of course, you're going to be looking at the 2007 Preakness Stakes. In this race, of course, you're going to want to watch the tremendous stretch drive between Curlin and Derby winner Street Sense. Let's roll the tape from Pimlico.
The Salute to the Champions is brought to you by The Province Sports, where you can read Haas Racing columnist Tommy Walski every Friday. The Province Sports and Tommy Walski. It all starts here.
They're in the gate for the Preakness, and they are off. The Exchanger gets off to a good start. So too, King of the Roxy is there. Hard spun and flying first class, and CP West is with the Vanguard. Under the line for the first time, and it is flying first class. Exchanger's there to his inside. Hard spun, going to be caught three wide, going into that clubhouse turn. He's trying to tuck in behind there, and yes, he's got a good spot. Hard spun runs in third. King of the Roxy is fourth. CP West is fifth on the outside. Curlin is sixth, followed by Street Sense on the outside. Mint Swarp toward the rail. Street Sense forced to take to the outside there. And the last of them all is Circular Key. So they make that way into the backstretch run now. And it is Exchanger who leads the Preakness field. Flying first class there on the outside. And it's five lengths back to Hardspun third. The quarter in 22 and four. Here's the half. 45 and 3/5 seconds. Gut-wrenching fractions here. Up the backstretch run. Five furlongs to go. Exchanger, Charlie, and there goes Hartspun. Hartspun makes an early and aggressive move for the lead, and now he's in front as the field moves into the far turn. CP West runs in fourth. King of the Roxy is now fifth, and then it's three lengths back. Curlin is running in sixth. Mint Swarp seven toward the inside. Street Sense is eighth, and he's still 12 lengths from the lead. Circular Key trails the field around the far turn. Three quarters in 1:09.4. Hartspun leads the pack, leads it by a length. CP West is pressing, and there goes Curlin with a bull run on the outside, and Calvin Farrell threading his way through on the rail with Street Sense. They are now fourth. Another big move on the turn for the Derby winner, and the field turns for home. Hardspun trying to get it out, and here comes Street Sense now into the breach, and on through to the lead, and Curlin's to his outside. Street Sense in front at the eighth pole. Curlin giving his all, a length and a half behind, and farther back, Hardspun is third, coming out to the finish. Street Sense, here comes Curlin. Curlin surging. Street Sense in deep water. Too close to call. Too close to call. A race of the whip from Robbie Alvarado. He thinks Curlin has defeated Street Sense in the shadow of the wire.
Okay, that's it for this edition of the Sporting Kings. And once again, on behalf of everyone here, we would like to take this time to say thank you for allowing us to be with you for this last half hour on this Saturday morning. Remember two things you're going to want to learn to keep them straight. Or on that final turn, you know who's going to be getting you.